Beautiful.
All right. Go away, cat. I don't want you near me.
Did you make it live?
Yeah, it's public. We're out there, baby.
I'm just waiting for my screen to... There we go. Now we've got live.
Wonder... It's live. Welcome. It live.
Welcome.
Welcome.
That's sorry.
I think that was the longest note anyone's ever held, like probably, in the history of the world of singing.
I am a beautiful, classically trained.
You really are. Like I paid you to sing, so clearly you're a professional. Like
yes,
done that. Yeah. Welcome to Husky Radio, episode 18.
The two-man version.
Two-man version.
Crimson Doubles is Crimson back. Doubles.
Fantastic. This is Kyle is, I think, in the ER right now. He's stitching people up and saving lives. And so we let him do that occasionally. We give him, you know, the night off and go save lives. That's a good thing for you to be doing. So it's just you have Scott, you have Tyler, you have Mega Magwitch, you have Mr. A. And we're here. We're
here to serenade
your souls on a. I am thinking about changing it, and I'll let you guys know first what that will be changed to. I know. I
penis fingers.
I think that's perfect. It really describes me. I think that's the perfect name. There we go. It's decided. Welcome tonight. We've got a lot of things to talk about. We'll be starting off with talking about our terrible Christmas movie.
Yes.
That Kyle cursed us with.
For anybody who's new to Husky Radio, as we probably have some new faces because we just posted that Dank Dance video.
Yes.
What we're doing for the month of December is every week we pick an awful Christmas movie that we watch and we talk about it.
And they're generally very bad.
Extremely bad.
This was our third man's idea, a boisterous biddy. Kyle said this is something he likes to do and has done in the past.
I don't know why he likes to do this.
I don't know why either. It is terrible. It is absolutely terrible. And so we started with the 12 Dates of Christmas, yes. And it was terrible.
And I miss that. I miss the 12 Dates of Christmas, let me tell you.
Oh, I wanted that one to come back with a vengeance because today's was terrible. This week's is Merry Christmas, and we're going to be talking about that. We'll be following that up with a little bit of Destiny Talk, the Dawning drop today. So, of course, we want to chat about that.
Oh, yes.
And then we'll get into a discussion about video game music. Scott and I have a lot of opinions here when it comes to video game music. And so hopefully we'll be able to entertain you with that discussion. Yes. Otherwise, we're just arguing with ourselves, and you're probably... changing to a better stream.
Boop, 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 boop. Changing.
And
Carlos, I'm so glad Carlos is like the only person I know who participates in the terrible Christmas movie Tuesdays.
I know there are some members of the chat that did watch the video. We've been we're talking about it on our Discord over the last couple of weeks. And when we get one of our mods in here, Fires will let everyone know. Is he in here?
He's in here. I'll hit that Discord link.
He'll let you know where the Discord link is, where you can chat with us all the time at all hours of the day because most of us don't sleep.
Yeah, that's
true. We'll be taking questions from the chat a little bit later, as well as telling you what this week's terrible Christmas movie is. If you want to join in, they're all on Netflix. That's kind of one of the priorities. And Netflix seems to have a plethora of terrible, terrible Christmas movies. So I'm really looking forward to this week's, actually. Kyle hit us up with it about an hour ago, and he said we have to read to you guys the description that's on Netflix because it's pretty good. Scott has not heard it. He knows the name.
I'm excited.
But he has not heard the description yet, so we'll be doing that a little bit later. Starting off, though, let's start with this week's terrible, 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 terrible movie. Merry Christmas. A little bit of background. Merry Christmas stars Carissa Lee Staples, who has done some video game voiceovers in the past. So she's one of us, guys. And Brent Doherty, who people might know him from Pretty Little Liars. My sister yelled at me. She said, "You don't know who that is? He's someone from Pretty Little Liars.
That guy's famous?"
Yes, Mr. Handsome Man is famous.
All right, well, that's good, I guess.
Scott, why don't you break down kind of a little bit of synopsis for us on this one?
There's no movie. This isn't a movie. This is nothing. This is the worst thing ever made by a human being. If humanity builds the Death Star and blows up another freaking planet with life on it, it will be better than this movie. It will not even reach the levels of awful that is this crime against nature.
Oh my goodness.
It's about a girl who she is with a terrible French sounding knockoff Robert Downey Jr. lookalike.
See, and I thought he looked a little Patrick Dempsey.
Well, like, Kyle said he thought he looked like a mix of Robert Downey Jr. and Patrick Dempsey.
Oh my goodness, that's perfect. He's got this terrible, terrible mustache and soul patch goatee kind of thing. And he speaks with an accent of some kind, but I have no idea where it's from. He's a jerk. Miss Carissa Lee Staples.
Yeah, and then she's like, well, I'm sad because my fiance sucks. And then the main guy is the world's handsomest chef.
Oh my goodness.
Who is complaining that he can't find a woman while he bakes cookies all day.
Bakes cookies all day long.
He bakes cookies all day and has a jawline that's chiseled by the gods. And
oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's a romantic movie. They get together. That's the plot of the movie.
That's it.
But there's no conflict in this entire film because they are basically, there's nothing keeping them apart 30 minutes in.
She tells the fiance, I'm done. And he's like, well, fine. And then he's like, wait, but I love you. And then he's like, well, fine. I'm going to go sleep with this ballerina who apparently they couldn't find any ballerinas in this movie.
No.
None of them actually knew ballet. It was awful. No.
They got like a 6 foot tall Amazon woman who did not look like a ballerina at all.
No. So a little bit of, you know, maybe some sort of affair going on there.
Yes.
And so there's really not a lot of will they, won't they, which I was expecting. We love each other
They already are immediately in love.
There's a moment of
It off with their fiance and then there's literally nothing. There's nothing keeping them apart. And then the movie has another hour left.
you're not even halfway through the movie by the time they've really gotten together. It's ridiculous. The writing was absolutely terrible. But Kyle brought up, Kyle kept bringing up a really interesting notion that that Carissa Lee Staples and Brent Doherty are two main characters who are beautiful, beautiful people, are perfect together. Like they're good actors together, and yet the script is terrible. There are lines and shots that make no sense. From the beginning, they're walking. She and the fiance are walking into this hotel, and you see a group of like two. It was two, right? Two cosplayers walk by.
I think I purged all of it from my memory already.
And they walk by, and I texted Scott. I said they're going to come back, right? This is important. Like there's some sort of con going on. And he goes, nothing is important in this movie. Nothing. And that really set the tone. That was so true. This was a terrible, 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 terrible movie that I wish I could just get rid of. And it's not one of those movies. I promise you guys in the chat, it is not one of those movies that is so bad it's good.
Yeah, no.
There is no redeeming quality to this movie.
There's literally nothing interesting or anything about it. All right.
No, it's an hour and 20 minutes of awfulness.
It is. It's bad, just like if a reality show happened
cinematography.
And they never planned out anything to happen on that day and nobody was interesting and that was it.
I realized though, right at the end, why Kyle picked this movie, why he finds something redeeming about it. At the end, we get this flash forward to a year later. So the will they, won't they is, you know, what was there is now over. They are together. We flash forward a year later. They're at the Santa Monica Pier, and they're riding around in the, you know, the Ferris wheel. And at the top, what was his name? Brent Doherty.
I didn't learn anyone's names. I spent the whole time like, how much time is
out? He pulls out a box with a ring in it, and he opens it up like this, and all you see, you don't even see the ring. Center focus is K Jewelers,
baby. I honestly believe this.
The whole movie was paid for by K.
No, like, here's what I think.
It's a long advertisement.
I think what it really is that flash forward scene was a commercial at some point, and somebody decided to try to write and film a backstory with just their free time for that commercial, and they had no idea what they were doing. Like
I sent a text to both of you.
Yes.
And I said, every Kissmas begins with K, because it was just so perfect. And that's the end. That's the end. There's no marriage. There's no like moving forward.
Don't watch it even out of curiosity.
No.
Like if you're seeing, you're thinking, it can't be that bad. It's that bad. It is.
It's so bad.
Watch like the first 5 minutes, and when you're immediately bored out of your mind, like that'll be it. You're done. Ugh.
Yeah. I wanted.
Carlos brings up a great point I want to touch on, is that the love interest guy keeps encouraging her to write this book.
Yeah.
About like, a nutcracker. Who the hell's going to read that book?
No one. Who wants absolutely to read a book? No one. He's like 80 years old and makes nutcrackers. Yeah. And of course, the main character to the main male character, the main female, you have to write this book. You have to write it.
Have you written that book yet?
It's what you need. Have you written that book? Like he sees her second, you know, the day later. Have you written that book?
How long does it take to write a book?
But he is, I don't know, maybe you felt this way. I felt this way. He is so handsome. I wanted to punch him in the face. Like, he's just ridiculously handsome. Yes. And all he does is complain about how he's been, you know, hurt before and he doesn't want to get in another relationship. And he owns a bakery with a catering company with his extremely beautiful cousin. And they have to keep saying in that scene, we're cousins, because, you know, he can't have any sort of love interest going on there.
Every single line in the script is like the person who wrote it thought that everyone watching is as dumb as them and needs everything laid out for them. Like, I want more Christmas decorations. Honey, I know that you're a famous director and your parents didn't let you celebrate Christmas, so you like really extravagant Christmas setups. Like, every line is that level.
And that was repeated in the next scene.
In bullcrap. Unnecessary.
He loves Christmas because he was abused as a child by his father who hated Christmas. Everything repeats itself. Like, you need to know every tiny little detail. She gives the
same breakup speech to her fiance twice. Like, exact same speech. Exact same. Like, exact 30 same. Minutes into the movie and an hour and a half into the movie, she reaches the same realization.
Same conclusion.
Times. It is worse than... I don't have a lot of pride for Destiny Cops. I think I'm a pretty terrible writer, and I put some bad stuff in there. This is worse than even anything I could imagine writing.
It's so bad. Like, I think, you know what? I'm going to go back on what Scott said. Everyone needs to experience this amount of bad in their life, unless you've been like beaten and starving. Like, this is what you need to do for fun, because it's so bad. It's so, so bad. Oh, I'm looking forward to a reprieve. I think next week's is going to be interesting. So, you know, stick around. This is something that we've got some people in the chat today. Stephen, we will be answering questions a little bit later. We try to watch the feed as best as we can, but it is tough especially with just the two of us.
Yes.
And we get so fired up about the things that we talk about.
Right. Can we move on to some good news?
Yes.
Some happy,
let's talk about good news.
Fun times. The dawning has arrived.
The dawning is here. First off, Scott, did you watch the cutscene for the dawning? Like in-game cutscene?
There was an in-game cutscene?
There's an in-game cutscene.
No. Like I do know that they're playing one, but I don't think I got to watch it because I was busy. Like we started streaming and I was trying to speed up to catch up to Will because he had already watched it. So I didn't get to pay attention.
It was fantastic. It really was. I thought it was really cool because it basically said there's a time of year where everyone on Earth, you know, puts aside their differences and comes together and basically celebrates the light, you know, this kind of, you know, all powering light that guides the Guardians. And that it was really cool because it wasn't religious, but it felt religious, but more like a humanity sort of coming together thing. You know, and voiced
we are the world brothers.
Yeah, no, it really was. And it's got its cheesiness. But I actually really liked it. Like I kind of almost wish the dawning was real. Like there was a time of year where everyone
5 years from now, Destiny 3's out. There's going to be people who celebrate like the dawning for real.
Like it's the new Festivus and stuff like that. Like, oh, I would love I love the dawning. Happy dawning. I think that's what you would say, right? Happy dawning.
I went with happy. That's what I go with. I don't know.
Merry dawning.
Delightful dawning. I don't know what else.
To you, Scott.
I don't know what else.
I would love it. I think it's so cool. Definitely worth watching the little cutscene. It's pretty short, maybe 2 minutes. Voiced over by your ghost. So you got what is it? Nolan Droid? Nolan Bot?
Yeah, Nolan Droid is what people call it, and Dinklebot. Yeah.
And Dinglebot. Okay, so initial thoughts on The Dawning. I'll start with you, and then I'll come
to
me.
It's pretty good. I mean, I like it. It's pretty good. I mean, it's nothing like, it's not going to change your world or anything. It's not the next huge update, but I think, I like SRL. I really like the new maps, especially the Mercury one.
I think, played yet, and I'll get to that in a moment.
Okay, we'll talk about it. I think there's a lot of cool new shaders, a lot of sparrows, which is going to give me something to shoot for, because I had almost every sparrow from last year, so I really like getting all the sparrows. I don't know. It's fun for me. And
I like to collect all the shaders, so it gives me something to do, too. It's gonna be
there's a lot of them. Like, I've already gotten, like, 6 new shaders, and there's still ones I've seen other people have, so that's always fun. I like the look of the tower in general. The festive setup is fun. Yeah. There's some secrets out there for sure, because we found, like, the one secret sparrow that's hidden.
Yeah.
And then I'm curious what else is maybe hidden. And I think strike scoring is actually in general better than I expected it to be.
Let's start talking about SRL, because I want to hear your thoughts there, and then we'll move into strikes, because that's what I focused on this afternoon. Didn't have a ton of time to play. Got home and pretty much played for 3 hours just to kind of get everything in and try it. And SRL was the one thing I couldn't get to. Let me tell you my thoughts on SRL before you tell me why I'm wrong.
Okay.
I'm not a fan, just in general. I think the racing is cool. I think it's neat. But I lost interest very quickly the last time around. And so for it to find out that it was coming back, I was kind of like, okay. I do like that. It seems like a pretty cool way to grind for stuff. You get a lot of things.
You do get a lot. And even they drop like levels. Good guns, too.
That's what I've been hearing, is they're going to drop IS Luna's been dropping.
Yeah, lots of people
like
getting
that.
IS Luna's and Party Crashers in my my teams.
And I think that's really cool. But I'm going to play maybe to grind for that, and then either go back to Crucible or back to Strike grinding, because that's just what I enjoy. What were your experiences today as you were playing it? Because I noticed you guys were streaming it for quite a while.
We were. We hit up some strikes and we took some breaks too. I understand why you got bored with it last year, and I think there's a lot of validity to that, because there's only two maps for 3 weeks or however long is a long time to just race
about
those
3 weeks.
Yeah, and that's like, it's not a deep enough racing mechanic thing to really hold your interest for 3 weeks if you're a dedicated player on two maps. But I think the core idea of SRL is really cool, and I like changing up the gameplay a bit for at least a little bit.
Yeah,
so
I can see that.
Yeah, and I don't think it's the biggest thing to get excited about, but I really do think that four maps is already a lot more fun to me than two maps. Yes.
Did you have any problems with rotation, or were you getting a pretty good mix?
We were getting a pretty good mix. I think the one I've gotten the least is the snowy fell winter one. We had a couple times where we had the same map back to back, but it wasn't a huge deal, especially since it's been a year since we've done the maps. Like, I'm not burnt out on them yet, I'm not too upset. And it didn't take very long to get the new ones.
Oh, okay. Yeah. On average, how long did it take to run a race? Because if I remember correctly, it was about the same time as a Crucible match, maybe a little bit shorter.
A race is usually only about 4.5 minutes.
Really? Long. Okay.
Yeah. Depending on the map, some of them are a little bit longer, but the par time for every map is 5.5 minutes. So.
That's right. I remember seeing that. Okay. Yeah. So that's not bad. You can play probably two in about a Crucible match time.
That's about right. That's pretty good. I'd say so. And you can go in with a full fire team, which is nice. Like, it's kind of like Rumble, only you can go in with all of your friends and get good rewards. Like, you can go with a full fire team of 6 people, just race against your friends and get IS Lunas, which is a great way to get gear.
So let me ask you this. We know that it's going to stick around in private matches.
Yes.
You'll be able to play it. You'll be able to load into it. Why not keep it public? Why not keep it in the rotation, something that you can do, anytime you want?
I'm assuming mostly for the reason that kind of what I just said, they don't want you to be able to go in with a fire team of 6 and
just grind.
Use the system and grind out great rewards all the time. You know, like, if you could just go in with 6 people, you could cheat to get every bounty for it done every day.
That makes sense.
Like, really easily. It's weird to me that they even let you go in with a fire team of more than like 2 people, let's say, because it's just like Rumble. It's a free for all event.
Yeah.
So
that makes sense.
It's interesting how they do it. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know what they're thinking in their little heads. Pro tip. if you're gonna race, though, by the way, use the Swift River if you have it.
It's got the highest.
The boost. Old Red Bull Sparrow got the highest boost of the trick sparrows. Boost.
Most important. So that's interesting. I think you're probably right. That's probably why they would keep it out, is they don't want people grinding it. I could see them. I mean, keep it active, make it a fire team of three or something like you would for a strike, and so then you can't take more than half of the people racing. I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't know, that's interesting. Was there anything as you were playing that you just didn't like something you, that could have been better?
I don't like not using the Swift River Sparrow. Other than that, I thought both of the new maps were both really great. The Fell Winter one is a little underwhelming to me in general. Like the snow setting isn't as cool as I thought it would be, and there's not as much quick dodging between trees or not as much jumping off of stuff as you would think for something that's on a mountain. But the Mercury one is really cool, I think. That's the hardest map by far.
Is it?
Yeah, and it has, because there's parts where, you can basically, kind of ride up on the wall, classic Mario Kart style, where there's, nice. There's usually a boost on the wall. You can be, on the wall a bit, or you can be middle lane or to the side on a smaller grading, but the middle lane will go in and will not be there sometimes, so you have to kind of make a choice of taking the inside turn or the outside, which is fun, and especially trying to hit the boosts while doing that is a fun little challenge. And
what license class did you reach today on day one?
I'm not sure. I wasn't even paying attention to my rank and stuff. I was mostly just racing it up. I don't know what I got to be honest. I got all the bounties except for the one done, and I finished all the par times in the book, and I've gotten the tricks and the gates in the book done as well, so I think I just need to get kills and races completed.
Well, and that was actually going to be my next question about the book itself. So we did get a new record book for the Dawning. Yes.
And the old book, if you have it, it's still you can still work on it.
Yeah,
with
for
USRL, because I have the old book and I actually completed one of the things in it today that I hadn't done yet. So,
do you think it will be? I noticed it has, a fair amount of levels. What, 20 levels? I think
it
was
20. Oh, I didn't notice.
Maybe 16. It's around 20. Someone in the chat probably knows better than I do.
They probably have it finished already.
But I was going to ask, do you think it will be hard for casual players? Vince is saying
11. Not 11. Even close, Tyler.
Okay, wow. Well, I rounded up. Fine.
There's 20 things to do in it. We'll go with that. They don't all give you a level.
Do you think it will be tough for people to max out and complete the record? Let me. Do you think it will be hard to reach those 11 levels? I'll start with that question. You don't think so? Casual players?
Especially, I think they can do it. If it took me one day to get almost all of the racing done, the other half the book is strike scoring specific, and I'm assuming that won't go away. And you can complete the book after the SRL ends, you can complete the book in private matches, they said.
I guess that you have really infinite takes time. Out that point.
It does, but even if they didn't, I really think 3 weeks is enough. Like a couple days of racing.
Yeah,
it's only 25 races is the number you have to complete. So at 4.5 minutes apiece, that's not that much. Really, for as far as Destiny goes, at least.
No,
when it comes to grinding Destiny.
2 hours. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's interesting. Because that was the first thing I noticed. I opened it up and I thought, wow, there's some cool shaders. All the tickets. Did you get a ticket?
I got an Amanda Holliday's ticket, the very first
one. What did you get when you opened it?
I got a sparrow. I think I got a couple sparrow horns, and you get a treasure of the Dawning. You get one of those in the box for sure.
Okay. Nice.
Yeah, and I can't remember. I think maybe a shader. It's hard to remember what I got from the box or what I got from the Treasure of the Dawning that came out of the box. Right. So, but yeah, it's worth it for the Treasure of the Dawning. I'm assuming each box will have one of those in it. I've heard completing the quest has that. So this seems to be, you got one for doing the heroic strike today.
Yes. Yep.
There seems to be a lot of ways to get the Treasures of the Dawning. I'm assuming that means they've just nerfed the RNG even harder than they did for Festival of the Lost, so they can sell as many still. But at least they're throwing you a bone.
Yeah, no, I got my one heroic strike today, and that had the Hunter chest piece. And then we were chatting, and I bought the package of five boxes. and I got two more chess pieces in those five boxes. So I'm good on chess pieces. Didn't get any of the cool. I got two things of the snow gear, the cape and the boots. Really want that helmet for the
helmet and the cape are all I want. I agree. Oh, I did get arms from the box too.
You got arms? Nice.
I didn't. Well, I don't think they're the arms that you can get like from the Treasure of the Dawning. I think I got this one from the gift, like the box with the tag. Because so it looked super ugly and weird, and I didn't recognize it.
So it's because there are two sets of armor. There's like kind of the boring, you know, like metal looking set, and then there's the cool, like white-ish looking set, which is what is it, snow cone or snow something that's the one that I really want because I love that helmet.
The helmet kind of antlers thing. I just think that's so cool for sure.
So hopefully I can get that in the next couple of weeks. Might have to buy a few more packages, but this is admittedly the first time I have spent money other than like the core game on Destiny. So because I really like that armor set and I got like nothing from the last Festival of the Lost. So I knew I would have to probably spend a little bit of money, which is okay. It happens. And I want it. I want that helmet, which means I'm not going to get it. It's exactly what's going to happen. Let's talk strike scoring. I personally love it. I think it's so cool. But I
thought it was a cool idea.
I love Sounds of the Elders, and so this to me is an extension of that. It's pretty. You got kind of an individual score in Challenge of the Elders, and I think this is pretty much a lot of team stuff. Like you are supporting your team, and I think that's really cool.
Except for the bounties are kind of solo
individual,
focused.
Right? Yeah. Right. You know, you need to get a primary streak. You need to get a special streak, things like that. Anything that you like, dislike about the strikes in general?
Well, I want to say I love the new versions of the strikes first.
Yes.
We can talk about those once we get the scoring topic out of the way.
Let's get the scoring.
I like the scoring in general. I still wish that like every strike had like a timer on it that kind of was a score multiplier, something that made it a balance between killing everything or running
moving,
it faster. Yeah. Because right now all the emphasis in the scoring is kill everything that's there, but everybody has built themselves into naturally speed run through strikes. So if you're playing with a random, they might just try to rush through and then you might not be able to kill everything fast enough for them. And it's a whole thing.
And I did notice that in the typical speed run strikes, I noticed it on Tanix. I noticed it on Valus. That people wanted to run through it as quickly as possible, but that meant you weren't getting the kill streaks, and so you ended with a silver. When if you had held back a little bit and fought all the spawns and everything, you probably would have gotten a gold. So that's going to change the way people play.
Say you said you weren't getting gold tiers, which I thought was weird, but it's because you were alone playing, right? And Will and I were together, and we were killing everything, so we were getting gold tier like no problem because we were specifically trying to just kill everything, get the bounties done.
And that's the thing is, I was getting a lot of streaks, I was getting my team a lot of points, I could tell. But everyone else is running through it, and so they're not focused on that same thing. Now, if you get all three people, or even just probably two, focused on the same objective, you're going to run through it a little bit better. And I think that's a cool move because people grind the strikes on purpose.
Yes.
You run through them quickly. This is going to slow people down if they really want to.
Something else to do. It's a nice little arcade effect in there.
Yeah.
I wish that it gave you your individual scores at the end of
Me
the
too.
Strike. It gives you your kills.
I was gonna say.
But a lot of kills are worth different point values, so it's hard to judge how you actually did in the scoring.
And your streaks, I think, work not just as points, but almost as a multiplier. It's kind of mysterious at this point, but it seemed as though if you did not die on a strike, you were going to get a higher score. The more you die, the less streaks you get, the lower your score is going to be. I would love to see a score breakdown at some point. What's worth what? And I'm sure
someone out there has already made it. Yeah. Planet Destiny will have something posted in like 3 minutes. Probably have one like 4 hours ago that they posted with what everything's worth.
and different ranks of enemies are worth different points. I love that. Different types of kills, melees, grenades. I'll be interested to see if, like Challenge of Elders, if this week the heroic modifier or whatever you want to call it is an extra for super kills.
That would be great. I would love if they added something else that changes up the gameplay.
You have to play the strike
differently.
Yes. I think that'd be so cool. You know, that just be a, to me, I agree. It's a completely cool addition, and it's something that I hope is kind of coming down the pipe. Maybe it's something like above heroic.
Yeah. Like,
challenge.
To play, to play
challenge of the Vanguard,
to play
or something.
To the Kyles of the world. I know if he were here, he's hesitant about strike scoring because right. He plays strikes all the time. He wants to run them the way that he's used to running them. Mm-hmm. And the scoring is going to change things, and it's going to distract him from how he wants to play. So I can kind of see how it might have been beneficial to have an option still to play strikes without scoring on them, if you want to.
Well, I think
out
that's
here.
Essentially what the challenge of the, you have Prison of the Elders and the Challenge of the Elders, and that's yes. what I would love is here's this level, and you know the gears, the skeleton keys and all that, they're all the same. It's your records and points, and it can become, if they tell you your individual score, now you can start, you know, playing as a team against each other. That's a lot of fun, I find.
Yes.
So talking about playing things differently, the new strikes.
Yes.
Holy cow.
They're cool.
The order is what? Tanix?
Tanix, Nexus, Will of Crota.
Will of Crota? So let's start with Tanix. What'd you think of that new Tanix?
Tanix is the greatest strike ever made. It's the greatest level of any video game ever developed. Adding anything to it, you would think would only hurt it, but they managed to keep the core elements of Tanix there and strong. I thought it was great. I really like that the fight is, he actually moves around now. The ways of the world are no longer just teleporting into that one
Holy
back corner
cow.
And getting the shit sniped out of him.
Yes.
I love the that you have to destroy the Siva mite clusters around the room
shield down.
To hurt
that
him.
That was cool.
Yes. And the different types of enemies can spawn in it now, which is cool because, like, you guys, you and Kyle and Sean played at different times, but you got hive enemies, but
we got
only
enemies.
Got fallen the whole time we were playing. Like,
yeah, and I think that's really cool. I think it changes up the gameplay, kind of like when they introduced some Taken strikes, you know, and you'd be playing and, oh, this is the Taken version, or oh, this isn't the Taken.
No, it was never, oh, this is the Taken version. It was, it's the Taken version.
Yeah. I would love to play both of them to really see what the difference is. But I really liked my strike. And I, again, like I said, I noticed, you know, people trying to run their normal patterns and they would get killed. When we get to Omnigul, I'll talk more about that.
Yeah.
Because I feel like that's such a repetitive, everyone has the pattern.
Yes.
But things changed in the Tanix and I liked it. I loved the line about Tanix basically being a total baller. That he can still talk even while Sivified.
Yes.
And they were like, what? He can talk? And yeah,
Tanix.
He's so awesome that he can talk while Sivified. Yes. Just in general, he's amazing.
Tanix is beautiful.
I thought that was so cool.
It makes him seem like he's actually a badass and not an idiot who just teleports into a corner and does nothing.
Exactly.
Although he's a little stupid for let's say the strike is his comeback. His comeback plan was do exactly the same thing I did when you killed me last time in the exact same location.
Yeah.
But the
Fallen Walker, to me, at least on my version, was very easy to take down.
I think Fallen Walker in general, the new walkers are easier to kill than the old ones. Like
they go down
the blasts
quickly.
That they shoot are slower. I think that's what it is the like six Siva charge things they shoot at you are easier to dodge than that immediate explosion that comes from the old walker.
Exactly. You don't get hit. And in the old one, you had to, you know, snipe the legs basically and then snipe
the
head. In the new one, we had cannons. Did you have the cannons?
Yeah, there were cannons there, but I always hang out in the top railing, so I didn't touch a single cannon.
Basically, the three cannons with some body shots, I think we only took out one leg the whole time. I mean, we just took that thing out. And we weren't a great team. Again, I was running solo, and so we weren't a great team, not super together. When we got into the Siva room, we did not wipe, but there were some deaths, and it took us a little bit of time. But yeah, I love, you know, you have to take his shield down. There will be a cheese spot. You know it's going to happen. Someone's going to figure it out.
Whenever it's the nightfall, someone will find a cheese spot.
Anything you were doing is probably not going to work in these new strikes. And I like that. You have to change, and it makes us adapt, and hopefully it makes us better players.
I agree. Speaking of having to change.
Having to change.
The Nexus.
The
which
Nexus.
I was really happy to run the Nexus again.
And
I
again,
forgot.
we got We got different strikes.
We did. We got different ones. So that's fun. But it was like, I almost forgot about the Nexus. Like when I was running it, I was like, oh yeah, I used to do this all the time.
I love that strike. I think that's one of my favorites.
That I'm leaning forward. Hold on. Let me just sit up straight.
You're going to hurt your back, old man.
That's fine.
There you go. Much better. I love the Nexus strike. And I loved it, you know, back in, you know, when it was still in the rotation, which it hasn't been for quite a while.
It's been, like forever. I forgot that it existed, honestly.
Until you're running through it and you're like, oh, I remember this room on Venus. Like, when was the last time you were really on Venus unless you were collecting a bounty? It doesn't happen. And so I love going through.
When you're filming Destiny Cups, that's when you're on
in
Venus
there quite a bit.
All the time. I never go there now because of all the hours we've spent filming there, but yeah.
I really enjoyed the more, you know, raid type mechanics, but I'll say we took out the Nexus Mine pretty fast. I was kind of a little bummed that I never got to pick up the relic because I was kind of on the opposite side clearing it.
See, I don't know the mechanics. You got to explain the relic mechanic to me because
I didn't pick up the relic, so I never had to figure it out. But he's got an overshield. You pick up the relic, you break the shield, you shoot him. It's pretty simple. Right. What version did you get? I don't remember.
In our version, it specifically made me play differently because I always stand on the same ledge during the Nexus, where if you stand back, his shots don't hit you, and then you can just snipe over his shields and hit him in the crit spot. I was up there and I was like, okay, so nothing's going to change for this. And then he hits you with a void curse thing. I don't know what the hell it was called. I can't remember what it was, but void imperfection, something like that. And so when that hits you, it lights up a couple spots on the ground that you have to go to cleanse yourself or you'll die, which forced you to get down near the enemies because they would spawn right by those, which was kind of cool. And it wasn't a very difficult strike because no strike is at this point. But there was one hairy moment where I went to get cleansed and I went to back into Will's bubble because we were surrounded by enemies and this bubble disappeared. And I was like, oh, crap. Now I'm down in the thick of it, which was kind of fun. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
no,
it's sort of the opposite of your mechanic was he gets a shield. You have to he gets a buff. You have to get rid of it. Ours was he gives you a weakness. You have to get rid of it. So
that's interesting. I thought that was really cool. Did you to get into the Nexus Mind like cave? When you're kind of still in Venus, you know, up top and you're kind of working your way down. Right before that, did you have to stand on the pad to unlock the gate?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so that's the same. Because that's a Vault of Glass mechanic.
When I was listening to Sean and Kyle play, because they were running it at the same time as us.
Yeah.
They were ahead of us, though. They said they all had to stand there. But I don't think we were all standing on it in our version.
I feel like it started and we only had two people in.
Yeah, I think it was just
one guy
when
walked
Will
in.
And I, got
it on. I think it might just be two because I mean, imagine if you didn't get a third person in your matchmaking, you wouldn't be able to open it. My guess is you could do it with one; it would just take longer. I don't think Bungie would build that in that you have to have that many people. But certainly, it reminded me of you know the beginning of Vault of Glass, where you're opening charging the plates and doing all that. And it makes me question, do you think we'll get some year one raids back?
I do think we will, or I hope we will in April. I think that's when
you think that'll be the April update.
I think that'll be the last update they make to Destiny before Destiny 2 will be bringing back all the raids, all your nostalgia for the last little bit, your last home stretch.
I think so too. I would love it to come back because I've run Crota a few times. I've run Vault twice. I want to say twice. You know what? One and a half times. That's what it is. One
perfect.
One completely. The very first time I tried to jump in, I came in late and these guys were like, "Hey, you need Atheon's Eye, just you know, jump in. We're about halfway through." And we four-manned Atheon. And then ran it a couple of weeks ago, maybe almost a month ago now, with Kitty and some people that are here in the stream tonight, and really enjoyed it. I think it's probably my favorite raid, honestly. I think it's the most fun. It's got a ton of lore. You're moving a lot. I think, I mean, we don't have to talk Best Raid tonight, but it's, no. I like it. I just think it's a lot of fun. And
see, I've only run it twice as well. I mean, I've only run it twice. So anybody who's in this chat named Ballistikitty or Invincinity, if you want to run that raid tonight, you know,
want to have some fun. Run Vault of Glass.
You want to run some Vault of Glass real quick. But no, I agree. Yeah, I think it's a really fun raid. And I would love if they brought it up because then it would give relevance for people like me and you who didn't run it much. I've only run it twice. Once when I first started playing Destiny, Will and Kyle and all them, they were like, all right, you got to run the raids because those are the best parts. So get up to level and we're going to run the raids.
And now you breeze through it. I mean, it's at our level, you breeze through it, even though the damage is capped to an extent, you're breezing through it. You know, you can beat it easily even using year one gear. And so there are actually times where you're not doing the whole raid in a sense. You're kind of, everyone knows the patterns, everyone knows where to run and what to do. So it takes 30-40 minutes, about 40 minutes probably. But it's fun. It is a lot of fun. It's a cool raid. And so yeah, I think Husky Raid should start doing old school raids. And
you think we should do retro raid streams?
Yeah, like who does that?
TBL, TBL guest does that. So yes, we can't, Black
we
Link.
Steal that from him. We'll have to come up with a better name for it and just tell him that we invented it on our own.
I'm gonna have to look up the Planet Destiny schedule and plug when he actually does. He does them every week. He does.
Yeah.
All three raids. He doesn't do King's Fall. He will only do Vault of Glass, Crota's End, and
Can you blame him?
Yeah, I know. I don't blame him at all.
But yeah, we definitely need to shout out to the Black Link, as he was a voice on the most recent Christmas special for Destiny Cops.
As the radio announcer,
he was fantastic. He's got a sultry voice. And those of you who have commented on my voice before, this guy will make your ears cry because he's got the most beautiful voice. He really does. I wish I had his voice.
Stunning. It's hilarious to me because I asked him to do it like last minute. I was editing and I was like, man, I don't want to have to do this radio announcer voice. It's going to sound terrible. I got this guy. So I asked him really quickly. Yeah. He's like, yeah, sure, man. Whatever. I have a gorgeous voice. I'll do it. And then he sends me what he labeled as test takes. And he's like, you can just listen to those and tell me what you want. And I was like, that's literally perfect. Your normal voice is what I want. Just do it. Like, you could have done anything. I would have accepted it. He does retro raids, I think, every Thursday on Planet Destiny. So make sure you look up and follow the Black Link. And he does his retro raid streams, and they're awesome. So
yeah, he's fantastic. Big shout out to him for helping with Destiny Cops. I'm certain that won't be the last we hear from TBL.
No, with a voice like that, Will has asked that he please take over voicing Winters because his voice is so good.
That's going to change the whole.
Yeah, it's going to change the dynamic a bit, but it's fine.
Something's wrong. We'll just write it in as voice distributor or something.
Yeah, he had a sore throat the whole first season. That was the problem.
He had strep for a whole.
Oh, man.
We got to talk about the last strike, Omnigul Strike. Yes. Honestly, not too much different other than, hey, here's a whole bunch of green haze.
Well, the boss fight, the boss fight is totally different.
Holy cow. Okay, that is different. Everything else is pretty much the same.
Lots of ogres, I felt like, one room. But other than that, yeah.
That final room, and so all of you remember that final room. You stay in that doorway.
The worst strike in.
Kill all the ads. Yeah. Run out. Shooter. Run back. That's the easiest way, really, to run it. It's the non-risky way to run it, let me say. But with this one, she spawns. You shoot her. She disappears. She drops a bunch of ads, and they come from everywhere. They come from the ceiling. So wherever you are,
trees, man.
They're going to drop on you. And you've got to run around. There were ogres. On mine. Did you have ogres in your room?
Yes.
I think at one time had three ogres in my room.
Oh, no.
Oh, it was awful. It was awful. Just ogres everywhere. And so it was a tough run. And that one, my team, we didn't run all three together because I was jumping through the story.
But
my team that time wiped at the end, and I can't remember the last time I wiped on Omnigul.
Because you just hide in that room.
You just hide in that room. You do not die. It's not that hard. Unless, you know, someone's playing like an idiot and you try to go res them and, you know, something like that. This one, we legitimately all got swarmed. And it wasn't, why didn't that guy revive me or anything like that? It was, we got swarmed by ads. It came out of nowhere.
But I think it's important to note that, like, the enemy placement feels more fair than
if you
were forced to fight in that room, the old version of Omnigoal, it would be completely impossible to beat it. I'm convinced
it would not be because they drop constantly. The same place, there's no place to hide. This they drop in, you can maneuver around, kill them, and then they'll drop on top of you. There's so much movement,
because
Omnigoal
leaves and she's like the most vicious enemy in the room too, like that just automatically
she's not spamming you with her
her constant
bombs
death
and all that.
Blast like
it was fantastic. I love that strike. Like, that to me is, I mean, I love the Tannic strike, don't get me wrong, but that to me is the,
it's that the one was a that great needed update. Changing the most.
That's the one that needed fixed.
Yes.
And so it's fantastic. The Nexus Mine is my favorite strike. I mean, Tannic is great, but the Nexus Mine is my favorite strike. So I'm happy to see that just back in rotation for its own sake. But Omnigoal was amazing.
I'm glad
the
to
way
see
they
it
changed
back in
that.
Rotation too. Cause I think, you should never remove content, as far as I'm concerned, that isn't broken. And the Nexus wasn't broken. There was no reason to take it out. Like,
now,
the same when Fogoth was gone. Like, why would they take... Why
take Fogoth?
Something? I want it all there that I paid for. I want everything from day one to still be there if it still works, if it still fits. And it does.
I am upset we can't go fight the Archon Priest. Because he's in the Taken War strike.
He got added in. He disappeared, got added in, and then just disappeared again. Like,
yeah, so he's gone, and I think that would be a fine one to throw into rotation. Personally, throw them all in rotation. They should all be there.
Exactly. There's nothing stopping them. Like, the design mechanics haven't drastically changed in the game to the point where anything feels outdated or broken.
People didn't quit. You know, people would quit out of Omnigoal for the longest time. People would
because you couldn't get a 3 a coin out of it, and it wasn't unless you were grinding the Nightfall for a Grasp of Malak. Most people didn't play it.
Exactly. Which I have now been grinding Omnigoal for a good Grasp, and I have gotten the world's worst rolls for 5 times. I've now gotten 5 Grasps, and they're all awful. That's more Grasps than I have of
exactly.
Imago loops.
You know, so. I had zero Grasps or Imago loops before, and now I have multiple Grasps, and I just got an Imago loop finally. So
congrats. Good roll? Bad roll?
A good roll. Not good. Yeah, worse than my PlayStation 1, which is already not good. So
there you go. Overall, I think we're super happy with the Dawning. It's a small update, I will say.
It's a small update. It encourages play, at least.
Exactly.
It has a lot.
That's going to stick around is going to be fun.
Yeah, they added a lot of bounties. Like, they have 3 from Zavala, 3 from the Vanguard guy who does bounties, whatever the thing is. So that's a total of 9 new bounties you can do. I think the Zavala ones are all weekly, and then the other ones are daily.
I like all the new bounties. They don't seem impossible. The one for Zavala, or the one for someone, I don't remember who gave it to me, that's 150 kills in a strike. That's a lot of kills. It's going to be tough. But that, again, that's probably something you would need to either, one, run on your own and just focus on killing, or run with a fire team.
That you're like, I'm going to be the one who gets the kills this time, boys.
We all get the kills. Yeah. Just weaken them. You can get all the assists. But yeah, overall, Dawning, pretty cool. I think we're happy with it.
I give it a B+.
I would agree with that. I was going to say
you're a teacher, so your grading scale is official. So I need to hear from you.
Oh, well, if it's a teacher grade, that's an A-, because kids don't normally complain about an A-. They're like, it's an A.
That's
but
good
it's
enough.
Not B. It's good enough.
B. Oh, come on. I got a B+. Can I just give some?
Just put me up to an A. Yeah, no.
That extra 1%.
Leave me alone.
Shut up. Let me drink.
Shut up. Let's talk about video game music.
Yes, while we have time.
We've got some time. And you know what? We might save some of this for a little bit later, but that's fine.
That's fine.
Unless you want to save it for next week. We keep saving it.
We keep pushing it off.
We got about 15 minutes. What do you say?
I say we go for it. We can at least talk old music first.
I think that's a good idea. I think that's a wonderful idea.
Because that Kyle would have been slightly precluded from that conversation.
He would. Anyway, He's more of a new school gamer, and that's fair.
No shame in that.
No, we're talking.
Didn't have as much access to it as a kid.
We're talking 16-bit. We're talking, you know, what's the best music? And so for me, when it comes to best music, I'm looking for something when, you know, in a time that was very limited, both visually and audio wise, auditorially, you couldn't do a whole lot. It's pretty much all MIDI in a sense.
Yes.
Like it's all very small. Not a whole lot of sounds. And so for me, it's got to be something that one doesn't stand out, but actually adds to the game, because that to me shows talent. And I think I have an idea of what, you know, what game you might pick. But to me,
you don't say. You might have an idea.
I might have an idea. but to me, a game that stands out to me was on the Super Nintendo, and it was called UN Squadron.
Ah, yes.
And UN Squadron, also there's an anime movie. Anime movie. It was called Area 88. And the movie's okay. It's not great, but it's about three different fighter pilots. And they're basically mercenary fighter pilots in this war. And it's really weird because once you're like in the war, you have to stay in like until you make $1 million or your 10-year anniversary passes. It's a really weird concept. And so the game takes all of this and removes it. It's just you're a fighter pilot, 2D side-scrolling airplane going up and down and shooting. I love it. I think I let you borrow my copy for a while.
You did let me borrow it. It's fantastic. I almost tried to buy you an arcade cabinet
of the
game once.
You did. But... Well, I think that's in the future. We will get that arcade cabinet.
Yes, we will.
But to me, the music is fantastic. It's not the kind of cheesy, you know, could it be like over metalized or symphonic? Yeah. It's like, dun, 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 dun. I mean, it gives
the,
you a
it's
sense
the chocolate
of urgency.
Rain song that plays on that menu screen. We'll recognize.
So true.
Yes.
It's fantastic. It adds a lot because it adds a sense of urgency to the game, and a side scrolling shooter is to me just the perfect way. And I wish that this game would have been remade or something like brought forward, but it didn't make a big splash either in the arcade or on the Super Nintendo. The anime is forgettable, to be honest. Most people don't know about it. I ordered it from some dude like in Canada on Amazon, and it was like mint in box for $8. So it's not a popular movie by any means. It's not, honestly, it's not that great. It's like 3 hours long, but the music in the video game UN Squadron is fantastic. It gives you that sense of urgency. I have to kill everything. And the game itself isn't, I mean, it's fun, but it's an arcade game ported onto the Super Nintendo. No save points, nothing like that, which is annoying. But music is awesome. So check it out.
There's aces in that game. I agree.
Yes.
Now, we
Scott,
all know.
What would you pick?
Look,
for
we
best
all
school?
Know when it comes. Here's my problem. My only problem with your pick, and in general, with old school music, the Super Nintendo, I think it has a lot of great compositions on it. I don't like the actual sound of the instrumentations.
I get that.
I think they're a little mid. They don't have enough high-end impact for me. That's what it is.
I would say they're missing bass, too. I mean,
yeah, they're very they sound like synthy of the time.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, they're not...
Okay. And that explains why...
They don't have a strong lead.
Synth music.
Yeah. They don't have a strong lead is what I would say for most of them, which is why I saw Invincinity put, he said like Donkey Kong Country. I agree that it has great music, but there's no like strong leads for me. And we know my favorite game series and obviously my favorite video game music of all time is all the Mega Man soundtracks, because they're just rocking songs.
Holy
they get
cow.
You amped up. They're all like catchy. They are perfect for their levels. Like, the NES has the best music to me of all old school consoles. Something about the chipset is just the epitome of nostalgia, and it's like the leads are great. It's really hard for me to pick just one game that has the best music, though. Honestly, I'd have to say Mega Man 3 is my favorite soundtrack, but other games on the NES. I can't sing Mega Man's praises enough. I do it all the time, so I'm not going to bother. Like, listen to Mega Man music. And in fact, I'll say the games, the other company, Capcom has great music in general.
Capcom
on the NES,
has wonderful music. Don't.
But I think the only rival they have is Konami.
I think that's probably right.
Konami's music, especially in the Castlevania series, I think that is what I'd have to say. Pick. If I can't say Mega Man, I'm saying Castlevania has the best music of the old school.
Holy cow.
Yes. Every song is like memorable in a different way. They're all leady, and it takes a game with clunky, awful controls and it makes it feel badass and cool.
That's a really good pick. I think you're probably right that on the whole, when you talk minimalism, but environmentalism and ambiance, like the NES has it. Holy cow. Like it really does. I think maybe there's a nostalgia factor for me in the Super Nintendo that when I hear
for
it,
both
there's,
of us, there's
it's
nostalgia.
Slightly, you know, it's slightly more symphonic. It's slightly more like there's more instrumentation, more to choose from in that chipset. And I think maybe that's what does it for me.
I agree, but you are not wrong.
I'm thinking Ninja Gaiden. I'm thinking Contra. Yes. Holy cow. Those are some great, you know, great
tunes.
When
it comes to rocking lead songs, like that's what I look for in video game music. And for Super Nintendo, you get more of the background symphonic songs that aren't
like.
That
is so true.
There's not like as much of a like, this is the badass melody guitar solo.
Yeah.
It's more.
I would say that the series that I would prefer on the Super Nintendo music wise as opposed to the NES would be Final Fantasy. They were able to do a lot with the music.
I think RPGs are where Super Nintendo stands out from music.
Of course. I think I would agree with that. I mean, that's where my heart is.
Yeah.
But definitely. But there are some, you know, there's some good stuff on both consoles. Now I'm surprised that we haven't mentioned Sonic.
Yes,
and I'm
which
certain,
is why I was going to say. When
is
it
Will
comes
yelling
to me,
at us in the
no,
feed?
No, he's not. He has not yelled at us. But I will say that when it comes to the 16-bit consoles, because I prefer the leads, the songs with the more singable like lead cutting through, I usually prefer the Sega sound chips, like the songs on Sega to the to the Super Nintendo, just because Sega is worse technically. The quality, has less musical options. But I like the uniqueness of the sound. It doesn't sound like a poorly emulated instrument. It sounds like its own thing.
No, there's a sound when you think of those early Sega games. Like there's a recognizable style, and I think that's cool. But I know Super Star Top. He loves the Sonic games, and so there's some great music in there. But overall, I mean, those old school games have some good music.
Music was better back in our day.
It's true. I'll say it. I'm an old man. Music was better back then.
Yeah.
Especially in games. Maybe, you know, maybe not late 80s and early 90s like Rock and Roll.
I think it's
great,
just a movement more. It's like 80s and 90s movies had more John Williams type scores where it was about like a memorable theme.
It feels like a score, whereas now it's background music for the most part. There are some great games, and I know that we're gonna talk about them
next week.
There are some great new games with amazing music, and I think what is being done in music is very different today than what was being done back then.
Yeah.
But I'm super excited to talk about the new music next week. But we talked about The Dawning for so long.
We did.
That we will have to.
Real quick, I want to plug one last thing for music.
Plug it.
Interesting thing about Konami on the NES, they had a chip in their games that allowed them to use one extra music line, basically, one musical line. Ooh. So if you listen, but it only was active in the Japanese version. So if you listen to the Japanese versions of the Castlevania 3 soundtrack, there's extra like little lines of music added in, extra harmonies and stuff, which is cool.
Would you say it's better?
I would say it's better.
Really?
And what I'm going to plug is there's a fan out there who used that chipset to remake the Mega Man soundtracks for like 2 and 3, but added extra melody and harmony lines into them. And it's amazing. And I highly recommend anybody who's into old school music. Check those out.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's cool. I like that. Well, we are just now hitting that 1 hour mark, like almost
perfect.
Here in 15 seconds. And so this is the point in the chat where, or, you know, in our podcast where we will turn to you, the fans.
You may ask.
Those of you still around. Yes. Any questions that you guys have? It's been a busy week here at Husky Raid.
Yeah.
We not only dropped a Destiny Cops Christmas special, but hopefully you have watched the brand new Saw Something dance video that's been, climbing the charts.
Oh, yes. brand new Destiny Cops episode starring our own Ballista Kitty and our own and Invincinity in the chat was in the dance, as was Ballista Kitty as well. So we got some celebrities in the chat.
Celebrities in the chat. What's the next horrible Christmas movie?
Oh,
you want to jump right there?
You just want to jump there? Should we pitch that while we gather accumulate questions?
So Kyle gave us the Christmas movie for this week. Again, this is on Netflix. And so for any of you who missed the beginning of the chat, because I know there were a few of you, every week in December, we are doing a terrible Christmas movie Tuesday. Terrible TCMT.
Yes.
And so here we are. This is week three. This week, we will be watching All American Christmas Carol. All American Christmas Carol. And here it is starring Taryn Manning, Lynn Shay, Wendy McClendon Covey. And it is categorized genre as holiday favorites and comedies, directed by Ron Carlson. And the Netflix description is, thanks to her neglect and her drinking, a self-absorbed mother is on the verge of losing her children. Can a trio of ghosts put her on the right path?
God. Ugh.
Yeah. I'm really excited about this one. All American Christmas Carol. So obviously it's a, Dickens Christmas Carol. We've got that going for us. We've got ghosts. We've got a mother, thanks to her neglect and her drinking, a self-absorbed mother is on the verge of losing her children. The picture, those of you, I don't have it or I'd show you. We've got kind of a drugged out, almost meth head looking mother on the cover. She looks sad. I would assume she's going to be like our Ebenezer Scrooge, who's just ruining the world for everyone around her. And these ghosts are going to show her how her life would be better. Now, I can already say that this will not be better than Matthew McConaughey's Ghosts of Girlfriends Past, which is probably the greatest Christmas movie of all time. But I'm looking forward to watching this one solely because it's not Merry Christmas. I mean,
that is a great reason to watch. I like Will has pointed, he said, is it one of those hacky Christmas Carol ripoffs? So I'm glad whoever wrote this is as original as us writing a Destiny Cops episode in one day. So I'm glad.
And I thought that was gracious. I thought that was funny. Kind of a hackneyed version of Christmas Carol, because they are made so often. It's a great, why mess with a good story? Yeah. But this sounds pretty bad. If you're just tuning in, because I know we gained some viewers here over the last couple of minutes. This week, the Terrible Christmas Movie Tuesday is All American Christmas Carol. It's on Netflix. We're all watching it. So watch it. Join the chat next week. And that's what we'll be talking about.
Yes. I'm gonna ask a question myself, because I've seen a fair amount of discussion of bagels in this chat for some reason. So I'm going to ask you, Tyler, donuts or bagels?
Oh, I'm a donut guy. I mean, I love bagels. Don't get me wrong. I think an everything bagel with cream cheese is extremely good. But if I had to live on like one bread object for the rest of my life, I'm going to choose donuts as opposed to anything else.
Fascinating.
Like anything. Bread. I don't want garlic cheese bread or anything like that. I want
garlic cheese
forever. Donuts.
I'll take pizza crust so I can still eat pizza.
Donuts are my favorite. Like they're in my top five foods of all time. Donuts are the bomb.
And I have to say, bagels. I'm not
You're a
fan
bagel
of
person.
Donut. I am a when it comes to breakfast, I am a hearty breakfast over a sweet breakfast guy. So I have to choose the cream cheese bagel. That's where it's at.
Fair enough. Fair enough. I will take coffee and donuts for every meal for the rest of my life. And I'll
I feel like half the donuts I have are disappointing. Like, yeah, so I just can't do it. They're hit or miss. You find every now and then you find like a really great donut, and half the time you get like a old prepackaged piece of cake. It tastes like it's not even not a cake, but like it's too bready. It doesn't have the softness of a donut.
Now, and see the difference. A bagel, you really can't do wrong on a bagel because you can top it with anything. Like, and it's gonna be, you can make a bagel sandwich. You can put an egg on it. You can put ham on it. You can put pesto on it. You can have bagel and a pesto.
That'd be interesting.
I've done bagel, ham, goat cheese before because I like goat cheese. I'm a weirdo.
Goat cheese is delicious.
Goat cheese. Thank you, Scott. Goat cheese is amazing. So you can do a lot with a bagel. Don't get me wrong. But you want me to pick one of the two?
I understand.
I'm
going to
pick a donut every
There's
day.
There's no war here. Give you can donut. Love your donuts. And if it's a...
They're essentially the same thing. They're brown. With a hole in the middle.
One is, I like the thicker bread. I think that's what it comes down.
Yeah,
I like
the donut. I'm a cake donut person, so I like that kind of
thickness.
What
about the...
it's got to be moist. I mean, it's got to be a good cake donut.
Are you a Rise and Roll fan for those people who are local?
Oh, my goodness. I don't know how many people local
Nobody. There's no way anybody can ever have one, but they're delicious.
If you've never had a Rise and Roll donut, you've never
come
had a donut.
Come to Fort Wayne just for the Rise and Roll donuts.
Oh,
one last plug for local Fort Wayne, Indiana businesses. Have you tried that new ice cream place by that Nate Click?
Yeah. Nate Click and his wife, McKenna. I have simply because I have not had any time off to get downtown. But you guys in the chat, you need to know about this place because it's amazing. It's called Yummy Bunny.
Yes.
And they take a donut, like what should be a filled donut, and it's not filled, and they cut it in half. And they put ice cream and toppings in between this donut, and then they serve it. Like, that's what they give you.
Yes.
It's the most amazing thing ever.
It's quite delicious.
Have you had one? I have had one.
Yes.
Everything I've seen, social media, they're killing it. Which is surprising because it's been, you know, like the mid-20s all week.
Yeah, I know, right? But when we went,
they're sold out every day.
Yeah. They ran out of like glazed donuts like right after us when we went. People had to get unglazed.
You took the last glazed donut, didn't you?
Yeah, I did take the last glazed donut. All right. I think we can probably end it.
I have not seen any
I've not seen a serious question in here from these people. Question. People are too fascinated by donuts and bagels. I understand.
Well, and some of the questions I'm very grateful our mods have been picking up, you know, things like what time zone are we in and stuff like that.
Yes, the softballs.
The softballs. Oh, those of you in warm weather, I am so jealous right now. We had like over 8 inches of snow Sunday.
Walking the dogs is a nightmare right now.
My dogs won't go out. They're just going to start pooping in the house because they will not go out in the snow. They get buried and get lost, and I'm not going out there to save them.
All right, so we got to stop talking about this. People don't care about our lives.
People do not care. Thank you all for listening to our Crimson Doubles Husky Radio episode 18. Make sure you're checking out lootcrate.com/huskyraid. Promo code SALSA for your...
Don't use promo code SALSA. If you're going to buy it today, if you go to lootcrate.com/huskyraid today and you enter promo code LASTGEEKMAS, you will get 25% off your order just today. So
LASTGEEKMAS. Can you post that in the chat? Can you add that?
Yes, I will. I'm going to type that. You say goodbye to them.
Thank you all for joining us. It's been a pleasure. We will be back next week. We should have Boisterous Biddy, Kyle, with us, and we'll be answering all your questions. Make sure you're watching All American Christmas Carol so that when you're in the chat, you can talk about how bad it is with us. You guys have been wonderful tonight. It's been a larger turnout than normal, so that's fantastic. You guys have a wonderful, wonderful week. Thanks for listening.